this one. Another one.
DJ Khaled, shining, shining, yeah. All of this winning, I've been losing my mind. Oh, hold on, don't try to slow me down. Hold on, don't try to slow me down. Slow me down. And I'ma make a fool for it. You gon' need a natural when I lose the boy. Roger, you a tool, the boy.
Daddy say I'm trippin',
mouth talking dirty, but my lips so clean. I'ma burn like a bumper car sticker. Better make a smile when you see that bitch pull up. Money don't make me happy, and a fella can't make me fancy. We smiling for a whole nother reason. It's all smiles through all four seasons.
Shining, yeah.
All of this winning, I've been losing my mind.
Slow me down.
I dropped the top out the coupe. They try to get at me, ooh. They say I'm sweet just like you. Said everything young, yeah.
Petty, I've been winning steady.
Yes, all up on your grill, the boy. Popping off after my thought, yeah, boy. Came on 97, winning 20 years, boy, oh.
All is good, I don't feel bad for it. When you see me smile, you can't be mad at it.
Money don't make me happy, and a fella can't make me fancy. We smiling for a whole nother reason. It's all smiles through all four seasons.
Shining, yeah.
All of this winning, I've been losing my mind. Oh, hold on.
Don't try to
slow me down.
Another one.
Make them wait. One ain't enough, I need two. And that makes the ace with the deuce. Hit a triple double in the garden. Held up my left wrist like I'm Harden. Ran to the dealer, bought twin Mercedes. The European trucks for the twin babies. Don't let me have a son, I'm a fool. Send him to school and all my dreams. I want a boy and girl to fight for truth. Whatever God give me, I'm cool. I've been winning so long, it's like alchemy. I've been playing cards with the house money. 21 Grammys, I'm a savage nigga. 21 Grammys, I'm a savage nigga. I should even work back with niggas. 12 solo albums, all platinum, nigga. I know y'all ain't out here talking numbers right. I know y'all ain't out here talking summers right. I know you ain't walking around talking down, saying bullshit when you were running right. Plain paddock, Ben had it. Flooded when I got it from Cali. That was just a thank you for us last year. Next year, gonna have to buy a pallet.
Shining, yeah. All of this winning, I've been losing my mind.
Massive success in their life. You know, I love talking about the people. Rob Dyrdek, as you say, started off as a skateboarder, no money at all. Kevin Plank, the CEO of Under Armour, $4 billion annual sales, didn't have enough money to pay a toll when he started his company, so they wrote him a ticket at the toll booth.
Wow.
Or Mark Burnett, the head of my show, right? ABC Shark Tank. The man was a special forces or one of those type of things in the military in Europe. He comes over here, first job, a nanny.
Wow.
He was a nanny. Second job, selling T-shirts on Venice Beach, right? Or let's look at, I always joke about it because I put up a post about Steve Aoki. Say, oh, the Operation Power Broke. Everybody hit me. You know, everybody judges things without reading. Steve Aoki's dad had Benihanas. He was rich. Yeah, well, that actually hurt him because when he went to the hood to play music and be down with the clique, the Keep It Real artist guys, they were like, take your rich butt home. Don't come around here, little rich boy.
Yeah.
And then when he went to dad and said, I need some money to do this and that, dad said, what are you doing? I came to this country with nothing. And if you don't work in this company with me, I'm not giving you a dime. So stop spinning those stupid little records. Now the man does $30 million a year, and he's the most touringest DJ in the world.
Amazing. Yeah. Amazing. I love it. So what do you recommend people? What's the first step in this process of learning this and understanding this? What do you recommend if people don't know? Besides reading your book, obviously. But
No, of course. Like, you know, in so first of all, let me be very clear, and I've had to make sure that I want to acknowledge one thing. I'm not glamorizing not having resources in your life.
Right.
Right? Because we all want to be able to take care of our family and have medical and have the things and an education, things like that. So
that's why people go on Shark Tank.
Exactly, right?
To get resources.
Exactly. So do not get me, don't make me say, oh, so I'm supposed to feel good about not having money? Not at all.
Sure.
But make that hunger, if you're going to be there, tap into that hunger instead of complaining or feeling sorry or thinking that something needs to happen, right?
I was just going to say it's more of an exercise of hustling essentially and using that hunger as opposed to let me just throw everything I have at it and see what works.
Right.
Yes.
And as I go through all those people, I want to show you that there's no one way to get to the level that you consider successful. But with this day and age of social media and technology, where there is no barrier to entry anymore of meeting and getting out to people, you can have what we call a proof of concept and test your idea. So I go through there step by step on what to do. So now in any business, no matter what, you need to have a proof of concept, meaning, hey, I may think that my cupcakes are tasty, but let me see how many people buy them.
Yeah.
Now, if you can't even make a cupcake, I'm sure you can film a 30-second video on your phone and tell of you making it or telling people about it. And you can get proof of concept if you have 10,000 people views your video.
Right.
Whatever the case is, right? And then you take that and then improve on it and start the process, right? Before, it wasn't that easy necessarily.
Right.
You know, before when I made a shirt, I had to go and either sell it on the corner, sell it to somebody, and then I had to find the person the next day to sell it to them again. Or if I sold it to the store, who would they sell it to? Who walked by and pick it up? Unless I'm going to sit in the store all day.
Let's see.
Was it a woman? Was it a man? Was it a kid? Did they buy it for themselves? Was it a gift? Did they buy it to wash their car with? I have no idea. Did they haggle over the price? Now, you know, you're on the computer, you go, boop, oh, somebody bought it. It's an 18-year-old kid, lives in California, loves a skateboard, has a pit bull, and has a bad case of dandruff.
Exactly.
Right? And so this is where we are today. So you can test your concepts very, very easily, and you can then be more equipped.
And so this week for your breakthrough, it's a chance for you to start to take a look at your blueprint anywhere you're really having pain. Hey, look, if you're doing great in some area of your life, celebrate it, of course, and I'm sure there are many areas you are. But life is really a series of growth spurts. I mean, two things in life make you feel alive, growing and giving. And what's really wonderful about this man, Joaquin, is he was constantly growing, trying to get better, trying to be a better teammate, a better basketball player. Think about it. When he didn't make the teams and he didn't make the NBA, he didn't give up. He worked even harder. The guy was always striving to become something. And he became it. And he achieved it. And then life took it from him. Isn't that the common denominator with so many of the people in the stories of this six-part series that you saw, these six specials? I mean, Frank and Kristen had a blueprint of what life was supposed to be about. we're supposed to get married and have children, and we're going to have our own business. And all of a sudden, life doesn't match the blueprint. And suddenly, there's depression. Because in their case, they said there's nothing we could do. But they were wrong. They were wrong because they discovered, and Frank discovered, I can make a difference in my wife. The chair, even though I didn't create this and didn't ask for it, this chair does not define me. I can become more than I was before. I can have the impact with my wife. I can have children. We had to change his blueprint because we couldn't change all the conditions of his life. Does that make sense? I couldn't get him to physically walk again. Maybe someday he will, but we can't count on that. What we got to count on is that he can be fulfilled by seeing he isn't helpless. And I did that through a series of experiences that violated what he thought he couldn't do. The same thing was true with almost every one of the people we worked with at some level. And in Joaquin's example, it was also true. Joaquin said, well, I can't ever have this quality of life again because I'm not a professional basketball player. And he was locked into that mindset. And all of us get locked at times. But to his credit, to a system of steps, we were able to break him out of that. We were able to get him to see that he isn't helpless. Because here's your choice. Watch this now. If you're suffering, if you're in pain, your life doesn't match how you think it should be, and you think you're helpless to change it, now you have only three choices. Choice one, blame something. And that's what Joaquin did, if you recall. He blamed his coach. He blamed what happened to him. And of course, these things were outside his control. But he blamed his coach. And a big part of the healing, if you watch this session, was bringing his coach in and getting him to see, hey, you know what? All that anger, all that resentment inside of you, Joaquin, A, it's not based on the truth. And B, like Nelson Mandela said, you know, having resentment in your soul is like drinking poison and hoping that your enemy will die. It doesn't work that way. And when Joaquin was able to break out, his breakthrough was a change in perception to realize this coach wasn't stopping me. I just felt like I lost everything, and so I don't know how to change it, so I'm looking for something to be mad about, someone to blame, so I don't have to blame myself, or I don't have to feel so helpless. Because when you're angry, you don't feel so helpless. You feel strong for the moment, even though it's a fake strength. When he was able to make that breakthrough, he could stop blaming. Because these are your three choices. When life doesn't match how you think it should be, blame something. An event, someone else, or yourself. As we talked about earlier in the series, blame games just destroy you. There's no progress when you blame. For the moment, you feel okay, but nothing changes. What are your real choices? You only have two choices in life. If life doesn't match your blueprint, you either have to change your life. That is, you gotta say, you know what? My body isn't there. I'm gonna go work out. My relationship isn't there. I'm gonna change it. You know, I'm not making what I gotta make. I'm gonna retool. I'm gonna get a new skill. I'm gonna go back to school. I'm gonna start a business. I'm gonna do something. You have to do something to change your life. Or, in order for you to be happy, if you can't change your life, you're going to have to change your blueprint. Usually in life, it requires a little bit of each. Does that make sense? And if you change your life and change your blueprint, you can have an extraordinary life. And what you witnessed this man do was once he let go of his anger and his denial, once he started to look at things, he began to find by spending time with his family that he was worthwhile being loved whether he played basketball or not. Of course, professional basketball was no longer a part of it. And we got to get Joaquin to shift that. And Joaquin is a metaphor for all of us. Because all of us are going to have times in our life when what we want or think life should be like isn't going to match how life really is. Those moments, if we blame, our life goes into pain. If we change, we can change our life and match our blueprint. But we have to also know when it's not within our control. And that's how we're able to make a shift and change what our story is for our life, what our expectations are, not by lowering them, but by changing what that model really is. I hope this makes sense to you. I'll give you a great example. Years ago, I do a lot of work with business people, celebrities, people of all kinds of walks of life. And I was dealing with a group of people, and they knew a very, very powerful celebrity. And without, to give that person privacy, I won't tell you too many details. You can't figure out exactly who it is. But it would be a person who was very successful as a woman, who was extremely attractive by cultural standards. A woman who's had a lot of dear friends, a lot of deep respect. So great skill, great ability, extremely talented, quite attractive, quite wealthy in financial terms, and lots of great friends. This would be, for most people's idea, the ultimate blueprint. If your life matches that description, you must have an incredible life. But ironically, this particular individual, as famous as they were, was depressed all the time. They had seemingly everything, and yet the person was depressed. How do you get depressed when you're smart and you're strong and you're beautiful and you got great friends and you're rich and you're famous? Well, it's real simple. People said, I don't know what it is. Everyone's tried to help her. She's been on through counseling. She's got all these different drugs. Nothing's working. She's taking antidepressants and she's still depressed, which is not uncommon, by the way. Because if you change the way you feel physically, but you still see your life doesn't match how you think it should be at some level, and you feel like you're helpless to change it, you're going to be depressed. So I said, bring her to me. I said, I can help her. I know that sounds like hyperbole, but I absolutely can help her. Well, how do you know that, Tony? Because I already know what the problem is. I know if someone's depressed, it's because they feel helpless because their life doesn't match how they think it should be. I just don't know what her blueprint is, but we'll find out what it is, and we'll either help her change her life or we'll help her change her blueprint or both. Long story short, and very quickly, I'll tell you the core of it. She came to me and she spent maybe the first half an hour telling me, apologizing, saying, I know I should be happier. I know it's silly for me to be depressed. I don't know why I'm so depressed. I know I should be grateful for what I have, and I am grateful. And it was all these reasons why she knows she should feel good, but still didn't. And I tried to finally explain to her, listen, I don't care about that. I care about you. The fact that you're not happy has nothing to do with what you have or don't have. The fact that you're not happy is that your life doesn't match the way you think it should be. And you have some idea of how you think it should be. And worse, if you're this depressed after all this time, you feel like you can't do anything. You have no power to change it. You feel helpless. And she looked at me in a certain way, and I said, so what is that? What did you want your life to be like? She goes, well, it sounds stupid. I said, it's not gonna sound stupid to me. She said, well, I don't know. I just always, since I was a little girl, dreamed that I would be married and I would have three basically perfect children and they would love me totally and I loved my husband, he loved me. And I said, okay, so how's that working for you so far? And she said, well, I think you know, because a pretty famous person. She said, I'm divorced twice. I have no children. And you know, I'm now X age. And to give you a clue, that age would be an age where having a child, your own natural child at least, barring a medical miracle, is not going to happen. So I said to her, well, why don't you just adopt? She goes, no, that's not it. And so what I had to dig under is, remember we talked in one of the earlier sessions about there's the surface problem and then there's the deeper desire or need. So I said to her, I said, well, what if you couldn't have the husband, but you could have the kids? And she smiled. She said, I'd take that. I said, well, why not adopted kids? She goes, no, it has to be my own blood children. So I kept digging to find out what was behind her blueprint. Because your blueprint is just a projection of what you think you need to be happy. But as human beings, we're notoriously ineffective at knowing it's going to make us happy. So much that we think we're going to make us happy, we get there and we go, is this all there is? So many things that we think are going to make us miserable and we can never deal with, we go through it and we can handle it. We're not good at projecting these things. All kinds of studies will show this. So I said to her, well, what are you hoping to get from these three children? Why do they have to be your blood children? And she finally said, well, if they're my blood children, I know they'll always love me. They'll never leave me. What was she looking for? Unconditional love. She had this big blueprint that said, White House, picket fence, three children, perfect husband, you know, all these different things. But what was behind that was a need to feel like she could have love that would be certain and wouldn't go away. So I can help her meet that need. So I said to her, I said, well, maybe one reason you don't have a husband is because every time you look at one, you're trying to figure out if he's going to get you those three kids in time and how that's going to happen. And maybe he feels a little stressed when you're looking at him this way because he can feel what's going on behind your bed, even if he doesn't know what the words are. And she started to laugh. She goes, I guess I've probably been that way a good portion of my life. And she goes, people wonder, you know, why I'm so uptight. I said, you're uptight because you felt like you're running out of time trying to meet some picture. But I said, all you really want is love. I said, don't you have a lot of love in your life? Tell me about your friends. And gradually, I got her to start seeing this love that she was trying to get was already here. It didn't match the picture. Maybe we could paint a new picture of what life could really be like and make sure that picture met her deepest needs. That's basically what we did with Joaquin. Joaquin wanted to be professional basketball player because he loved basketball, yes, but also because he wanted to be that man who was a leader. He wanted to be the man who was the good man. He wanted to be the one who brought energy to people. He wanted to be the man people would look up to. He wanted to be the man who could take care of his family in style, all of his family, not just his daughters and his wife, but other people as well. Underneath it all, he wanted to know that he mattered. And through the process that you saw in this show, he began to find out that he didn't need to be angry at the world, that yes, his blueprint was taken from him, but his soul and his ability to be a special human being that could touch other people was not taken from him. That maybe his real gift was his ability to inspire young kids, his ability to get himself to do whatever it took. How did he become a professional basketball player? Unbelievable discipline, unbelievable drive. He started bringing that to picking up trash and the game started to change. He started to have fun there. He could come home and take care of his kids and pay his bills. That doesn't solve everything, but it gives him a way to suddenly regain himself. When he sat around with all of his family, and you saw part of those scenes, and if you watch little areas of browsing this week, you'll see some more scenes from his family where you see him begin to realize they love me whether I'm rich or poor. They love me whether I'm a professional basketball player or not. They love me. That's what he was really after. And when he got that, it allowed him to let go and say, I can do other things. That doesn't mean he won't have challenges. We're all going to have challenges in our life. It doesn't mean that at times he won't wish he's doing more. But he's no longer stuck. He's broken through because he now knows I have control. I can change my life or I can change my blueprint. And when I do, I can fulfill it. I can start to feel that aliveness. Now here's the trap. What do you think happens once you fulfill your blueprint regularly? Once you figure out how to do what you always dreamed of? You always dreamed to live a certain way, and now you're living that way, living that way, living that way every day. Well, the human nervous system, the human spirit needs to grow. So pretty soon you'll get bored with that and you'll come up with a new blueprint. That's part of the part of life that's exciting. See, if you and I from this day forward are gonna be happy, just remember what we've said. It takes two things, grow and give. A meaningful life comes from growing, that sense of progress, and it comes from having life not just be about me, but about we, doing something that makes me feel connected to other people besides myself. That growth, that sense of contribution fills a deep spiritual
to be someone.